Santa's resentful and destructive older brother is forced to work with Saint Nick, as he helps him and the elves get preparations ready for Christmas, in hopes of getting a nifty 50k, and that's why today in Flick Summary, Fred Claus. Let's travel all the way back to whenever this was. A baby named Nicholas is born, one who displays certain characteristics that might remind you of a particular someone.
Ho, ho, ho.
That's right, that's our Nick, our very own Santa. His proud mother coaxes her other son, Fred, to come meet his brother. Instantly, Fred felt an overwhelming sense of love and protection over his brother. He promises Nicholas he will be the best older brother ever and that he would always keep him safe. As the movie's narrator says, it's a lot easier making promises than it is to keep them.
Remember, all I'm offering is the truth.
Fast forward a few years later, and on the day of Nick's birthday, Fred excitedly gives him a present he made himself, a journal with his name on it. Nicholas gladly accepts it, but adds it to another pile of his presents, claiming that less fortunate children need it most. Deflated, Fred slowly but surely starts resenting his brother, as his mother constantly encourages to be more Nicholas, or Saint Nick, as she calls him. Over the years, he does his very best to avoid projecting his resentment onto his younger brother, until at one point, after Nicholas accidentally makes his brother's bird run off, enough was enough, and Fred couldn't stand him any longer, and started withdrawing from him.
Do you get to that point of enough is enough?
Once the boys had grown and gone their separate way, Nicholas was indeed granted sainthood within life, which meant that his family basically became immortal, along with him. Fast forward to now, a time we might be a little more familiar with, Fred remains a bitter, self-centered, but caring man, while Nicholas has become the modern-day Santa we all know and love. Now living in Chicago, Fred makes his bread by being a repossession agent and does all sorts of fun things, like taking away a plasma TV from a little girl.
And you have a 55-inch plasma TV in your room?
Santa got it for me for Christmas last year.
Big guy in the red suit's not looking out for your future, is he?
How thoughtful of him, right? Fred returns to his home, where he has placed the plasma TV, and gets occasional visits from his friend down the street, named Slam, an orphan he tries to take care of. We then meet Wanda, Fred's lovely girlfriend, who senses that her boyfriend is not as committed to their relationship as she was. She turns out to be right when Fred, after pretending to be one of those Santas who dresses up for charity, is arrested on her birthday, standing her up when she specifically asked him not to. In jail, and with no other options, Fred calls Santa up at the North Pole, asking him to pay for his bail of $5,000. Without skipping a beat, Santa accepts, which leads to Fred asking for even more money, just a shy 50k. But Santa refuses, telling him that if he wants that money, he had to earn it.
But if you want the rest of this, then you're just gonna have to come up here.
With a sigh, Fred agrees. Finally out of jail, Fred attempts to talk to Wanda about what happened and tries to change her mind about dumping him. He tells her he has to leave for the North Pole to work with his brother, but she doesn't believe it, effectively ending the relationship. That same night, Fred gets a visit from CPS after Slam asks him to pretend to be his dad. Seeing that he will no longer be able to be there for him, he tells Slam to go with them, which he not so excitedly does so. Later, Willy, Santa's hat elf, picks Fred up to fly him over to North Pole with a full set of reindeer and a sleigh. Cool! We promptly arrive at the North Pole, where we also meet Charlene, an elf that has captured Willy's romantic attention, although she doesn't even seem to remember his name. Anyway, after getting attacked by some ninja elves, Santa and his brother are finally reunited and tells Fred he will be comfortably rooming with Willy.
You sure you wouldn't be more comfortable down here on the bottom?
I don't think it's gonna make much of a difference, Willy.
Well, I'm not sure how comfortable it's going to be for a human to sleep on an elven bunk bed, but okay. The next morning, Willy and Santa give Fred a whole tour of his workshop, where he quickly blends in with the spirit of Christmas.
Can I get a ho, ho?
No.
Ooh, you screwed, you lose.
Santa then takes Fred to the naughty and nice department, the heart of the whole process, and explains how everything works to define who's naughty and who's nice. He tells Fred that his role in the North Pole will be classifying the kids under the category that fit them the most. If they strike him as nice, they're on the nice list, and the same goes for the naughty kids. Sounds pretty simple, right?
Easy peasy lemon squeezy.
Santa then gets a visit from an efficiency expert named Clyde Northcutt, who he hopes to impress. Not even 3 minutes into his drop-in, Mr. Northcutt tells Santa some rather upsetting news.
The board is seriously considering shutting you down.
Yikes. He tells him that if he gets 3 strikes during his stay at the North Pole, he will shut down the entire operation, effectively killing Christmas for all the kids in the world. How sweet. With nerves and anxiety through the roof, Santa promises that everything will be just fine. Or so he thinks.
Don't make promises you can't keep.
Back at the workshop, Fred is having a hard time concentrating when all the DJ plays is Here Comes Santa Claus over and over, driving him to insanity. He decides to take matters into his own hands and plays a little rock music to switch things up a bit, which originally spooks elves but quickly grow to love it.
I like it.
The elves and Fred start dancing and going all out with the new music that's playing. Unfortunately though, right then and there, Santa and Mr. Northcutt enter the room, witnessing the absolute madness going on. Although they stop right away, Northcutt still gives Santa a strike due to a lack of discipline.
Well, that's just great.
Santa manages to let go of his frustration and asks his brother to join him for dinner that night. At first, Fred gladly accepted, but upon noticing his mother through the window, he instantly wants to back out, begging his brother to cut him some slack and let him go back to Willie's place. Despite his protests, Santa manages to get Fred in the house where Northcutt also happens to be. They manage to have a simple, nice, not hostile at all family dinner in front of the man that holds the future of Christmas in his very hands.
Happy anniversary, I hope you choke on your meal.
Yep, not hostile at all. Obviously, Northcutt notices the dysfunctional family Santa has, which I'm sure doesn't look good at all for his reports.
I just love meeting people's families. I find it so revealing.
After dinner, Fred goes to the North Pole's bar and shares a drink with Willie. Charlene, the elf woman that Willie likes, is also there and still remembers Fred's name, but can't manage to retain Willie's.
You're tearing me apart!
She leaves the bar and the poor elf is absolutely devastated that his crush doesn't even know who he is. Fred tells him that he will conquer her by dancing, as he gives him a brief dance class. Willie is able to feel confident when he dances, but unfortunately falls flat on his face just when Charlene walks in yet again, having forgotten her gloves. Willie is absolutely mortified and quickly leaves. At home, Fred gives him some inspiring words of advice and encourages him to keep trying, finally cheering his friend up. We then cut back to Northcutt, who has broken into Santa's workshop, sabotaging just about anything he can find in order to shut down Christmas as soon as possible. Unfortunately, he centers right in Fred's station, the naughty and nice department, and shreds the Christmas list of thousands of innocent kids.
I think you're evil!
The next day, Santa scolds Fred for losing the files of the children around the world, and the list with the presents they asked for. Fred tells him he had nothing to do with the disappearance of the records and indignantly walks away. Northcutt shows up seconds after and plays the innocent card.
Trouble?
No, no, no.
No! Nobody in Wisconsin's gonna get any gifts this year!
He asks Santa if he has any backup records, and upon seeing that he doesn't, he gives him strike 2, failure to administer backup records. Mr. Northcutt then tells Santa about his concerns about Fred and suggests giving him a lesson. Apparently, Santa took Northcutt's words of advice seriously and sends a pack of ninja elves to Fred's office to basically kidnap him and schedule a family intervention, with Wanda, his ex-girlfriend, making an appearance.
The gang's all here.
After the entire family gang up on him and berate him, Fred has enough and turns the whole thing on them. Even Wanda, the girl he was apparently trying to win back. I guess family intervention wasn't too much of a good idea, huh?
My family and I love you, but you're terrible. You're all terrible.
Once he leaves, Fred has a run in with Northcutt, who attempts to have him turn on his brother by playing the classic card of,
"You and I are not so different."
He says something about living under someone's shadow that resonates with Fred, but we'll get to that in a little bit. The following morning, the top 10 naughty list gets updated, with Slam, Fred's little friend from Chicago, taking the number one spot. Fred then asks the magical crystal to show him what Slam is up to. He sees that he is having a hard time at the orphanage, as he is repeating the same exact things Fred told him about his brother before leaving to the North Pole. There, Fred has a full-on breakdown and decides to stamp the remaining files as nice, knowing that Slam is a good kid and is only imitating Fred's harsh words. This time around, Santa doesn't go easy on Fred and full-on screams at him for stamping every naughty kid as nice, and has now ruined Christmas as he can't deliver the presents in time.
Congratulations, Fred! You've caused Christmas for the whole planet! Everybody!
Fred then tells Santa some whatever insults about his weight, and they quickly engage in an aggressive snowball fight. Things then escalate quite a bit, as a car gets involved and they even destroy some property. Fred then confesses his hate for his brother, who only tells him that Northcutt is one strike away of shutting him down permanently. Fred then prepares to leave, while Annette, Santa's wife, gives him a check for $50,000 and a present from his brother. Northcutt then tells Santa he knows about what Fred did and gives him his final strike, as he confesses that he is happy about shutting him down for good. Finally, back in Chicago, Fred opens the present that Santa gave him that included a birdhouse and a little note, apologizing for cutting down a tree and making his favorite bird escape back when they were kids. Fred goes to a recovering sibling support group, where all sorts of lesser-known siblings attend, where he gets some inspiring words of advice and decides to travel back to the North Pole. Once there, Fred wakes Willy up and instructs him to get the other elves, motivating them to make as many presents as possible within the span of 10 hours. They decide to make baseball bats and hula hoops, given that it is quick and easy. After convincing the elves to make the toys, Fred goes to Santa's place and tells him the good news. However, it appears that Santa sustained some minor injuries after the snowball fight and isn't able to deliver the presents. Willy tells him that only Claus is allowed to deliver the presents whenever Santa is indisposed.
How convenient!
Before answering, Fred rants about the naughty and nice list, as he says that there are no naughty kids and that they are all good kids. A few moments later, we see Fred in all his Santa's Q glory ready to deliver the presents.
Red Fred has entered the building. I repeat, Red Fred has entered the building.
He brings Willy along with him to prepare the slide, but Mr. Northcutt stands in the way, trying to do everything he can to stop Christmas from happening. But Fred just won't have that.
Fred, if you don't get out of the way of this sleigh in about 3 seconds, you're gonna make me the happiest guy in the North Pole.
He gets away from Northcutt and gets to delivering all the presents, struggling a little bit as he does so, but nothing too major.
Are you sure you've never done this before? Because you're driving like an absolute pro.
Fred decides to wake up Slam in his Santa disguise to give him the very thing he asked for, a puppy, and tells him to believe in himself. Mr. Northcutt cuts all communications from the North Pole to make the deliveries almost impossible. Santa then remembers Mr. Northcutt was the naughtiest kid during Christmas 68, finally understanding that it was a matter of revenge. Santa apologizes for not giving him a present then, and decides to give him what he asked for that same year, a Superman cape.
I think you can never accept my apology.
He finally turns Northcutt on their good side, and Santa understands he had a misguided notion of naughty kids back then. Willy and Fred deliver the presents on time and return to the North Pole safely. Willy finally makes his move on Charlene, the elven girl he liked. Fred, his mom, and Nick make amends, while our leading guy finally patches things up with Wanda and takes her to Paris with a sleigh and reindeer. Northcutt started working in the North Pole, and Slam finally got adopted. Well, I guess you can call that a happy ending, right? And that's all for today. Make sure to stay tuned, as we'll be doing more Christmas movies for the whole month. In the meantime, let me know in the comments what you want for Christmas, and I'll deliver it to you if you subscribe. Nah, just kidding. But subscribe anyways.
Merry Christmas, and see you next time.